War, George and Homer both decided to make their homes in Kansas. And one of the reasons for that, as best I can tell, is that when they enlisted, they were promised 100 acres of land if they would enlist and serve the duration of the war, which they did. So they settled in the Fort Scott area and lived there the rest of their lives. They don't seem to have had a lot of money, but they were comfortable, highly respected members of their communities. It's interesting to me that George was so gung-ho to enlist at 16 and then seems to have gotten everything he ever wanted out of life and settled into a very quiet life. But they were respected members of their communities. They were very well known. The obituaries at George's death talked about how significant a part of the community he was. He was a member of fraternal organizations and a community leader, and so they were well respected, but just very content with that kind of life. James, on the other hand, appears to have been restless his entire life. I mean, he just had to be out there. You know, I think he was just kind of driven to succeed, to make something special of himself. His wife had died at an early age, and he was sort of rootless and decided to join his brothers in Kansas, and decided to move on. He actually moved on to Colorado and on to Utah. While he was in Utah, he met the 19th wife of Brigham Young. Her name was Ann Eliza Young. She was the last of his wives, and she was on the verge of apostatizing from the church. And James Pond had a hand in helping her to leave Brigham Young's family. But she decided that she wanted to talk about her story, and Pond thought, well, that would make an interesting conversation. We might make a little money on this. So he started promoting her out locally, and they did quite well. So well, in fact, they got so much positive feedback from the newspapers that he decided perhaps they ought to schedule an Eastern lecture tour, and finally decided that he was doing so well that he would start his own agency in New York, and did that and became the Pond Lecture Agency. He was the preeminent talent agent in the country for the rest of his life. His regular clients included Mark Twain, Emerson, Walt Whitman, Robert Louis Stevenson, musicians, explorers, scientists. So Pond knew virtually every celebrity in the country. I mean, they all worked with him. He was just an astonishing celebrity. He was known wherever he went. And they talked about what an incredibly good company he was. He was a storyteller. Even Mark Twain, whose reputation is as a storyteller, said, you know, Pond is one of the best you've ever listened to. He wrote a letter to William Dean Howells, who was an American novelist, and said, I'm happy to hear that you're going on tour with Pond. He's one of the best yarn spinners you'll ever see in your life. So for a rural Wisconsin kid who barely got any education to live a lifestyle like that in New York with all of these celebrities is really a pretty amazing accomplishment. And he apparently brought it off beautifully. I mean, he fit into that society.